Give this woman to be married to this man.
Her mother and I.
I'm gonna take a breath. You may be seated. Well, what do you get when you marry a football player in January? Wedding outside, no matter the weather. And here we are. Here we are celebrating this special day. I believe that the presence of God is already in this place, but if you'll bow your heads with me and pray as we acknowledge his presence. Heavenly Father, Holy God, we believe that this moment has been divinely orchestrated since before time began. You knew that these two people would exist, that they would have faith in you, and that today they would be bound together as one. We thank you for what you have done, Father, to form Tim into the man he needs to be. Thank you for what you've done to form Emily into the woman she needs to be. And now, we ask that you let this ceremony be pleasing to you, that you will honor the covenant of marriage that is made here today, and that from this moment forward, you will be honored and glorified by these lives joined together as one. We love you in your name. Amen. 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 This time, I'm going to invite John to read a scripture for us.
This reading is from
This reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 13. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always preserves. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be still. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now we see only a reflection, as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, love. But the greatest of these is love.
Thank you. Tim, I have had the privilege for the last few months to be your pastor, to be your counselor, and to be your friend. We spent a lot of time together. We spent several hours together talking about this day and all the days after this day. I can tell you all who stand here as witnesses that they are ready for this moment. They are prepared, their hearts are joined, and their romance has propelled them to now make a covenant with all of us standing as witnesses. God pays attention to what's happening here today, and all of us are standing witnesses of what's happening today. And to him will be all the glory, not just for what happens in this ceremony, but for all the days following. But before I give you the rings to exchange, and before you say your vows, I'd like to give you a few brief words, my final pastor-counselor words, before I send you into this. These are not just my words, though. I believe these are words from the Lord, things I want you to remember all the days of your life. The first is, remember that you are making a covenant today, a promise. Our God is a promise-making God. We talked about that. He makes promises with us, and God always keeps his promises. Today you're making a promise to one another to be loyal, to be faithful, to support, to protect, and to provide for one another. We live in a day and age where promises are easily made and easily broken. Pie crust promises, as my grandma calls them. But that's not how marriage should be in God's eyes. Marriage is a promise you're making before an eternal God saying, I will care for this woman. I will care for this man. I will keep this promise no matter what happens. The romantic love that you share, I've seen evident as we've sat in the PQ coffee shop or in my office, the romantic love that you share has propelled you to this point of making this promise. The romance is not going to fade past this point. It's something you will still tend to. But the romance has now gotten to the point where you say we must have a covenant to solidify what we share here that is so special. I remember in our first session together, I asked you why you wanted to marry each other. I remember, Emily, when I asked you, you said, because he showed you unending love. He leads you firmly. He's your best friend, a source of joy and laughter. You told me that you've fallen in love with the way he makes you laugh, he encourages you, he treats you, and cares for you. And then you said, his good looks and athletic ability were an added bonus. Remember that love and attraction. Remember that love and attraction propels you to make this covenant. It's not imposing itself upon your love. Christ spoke about the permanence of the marriage bond when he said in Mark 10, verse 9, what therefore God has joined together, let no man tear apart. There will be times where you're tempted to let your love fade. Maybe your own heart will challenge you and say, let it go or don't fight for it. But I'm telling you, fight for the love. Fight for the covenant. Don't let other people distract you from that covenant or that promise. And don't let the enemy or your own heart serve as a distraction. Not even the two of you should tear apart what God is joining together today. Remember that God sees this promise. It says in Malachi 2, verse 14, that he stands as witness to the promise you make with the wife of your youth. He stands here today. Just as these witnesses stand here, so also God stands here. The second thing I want you to remember is that marriage is God's design for true companionship. When God first created man, he saw that man needed a companion, a partner, so he created Eve for Adam. Adam was incomplete by himself. We know that in Genesis chapter 2, verses 18 through 23. And then God put him to sleep, and from his rib created this woman, this perfect companion. And I imagine that when he woke up, his reaction to Eve was similar. The reaction that you have about her of, whoa, man, she's mine. She's mine. It's beautiful. It's a companionship designed by God. Let me remind you that this companionship is exclusive. It's only for the two of you to be solely shared between you two. It requires that you leave the bond that you have with your parents as children, and now you bond to each other. Though Jan and Ben and Don and Dale have been amazing parents, now you will be your own family. You will be bound together as one. Remember to share that bond and tend to the companionship. Be each other's best friends. Date. Fall in love all the years of your life. Finally, I want you to remember that marriage is God's greatest illustration of salvation. The two of you are joining together in true love. Love that has been given to you by God Almighty, who is love. And as you live out this marriage, you will fall more in love with each other. And my hope, as your pastor and counselor and friend, is that you will fall more in love with the Lord as well. That through the marriage relationship you share, you will experience the gospel and the goodness of Jesus Christ. That you will have him as the center of your life and the Bible as the foundation of your relationship. So remember, the covenant you're making today is before God, and we're all standing here as witnesses. Well, preserve the companionship no matter the cost, and grow closer to God as you learn more about Christ's relationship with us through the relationship that you share with each other. At this time, you're going to exchange vows and rings. Vows is a verbal promise that we're all standing witness to, a promise you're making to one another. The ring will then be a symbol of the vow that you are making. This is very simple. Even with nerves, all you have to do is repeat after me. But say this to one another. Tim, I'm going to have you go first. Say, I, Tim.
I, Tim.
Take you, Emily.
Take you, Emily.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
My constant friend.
My constant friend.
My faithful partner.
My faithful partner.
And my love from this day forward.
And my love from this day forward.
In the presence of God.
In the presence of God.
Our family and friends.
Our family and friends.
I offer you my solemn vow.
I offer you my solemn vow.
To be your faithful partner.
To be your faithful partner.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In good times and in bad.
In good times and in bad.
And in joy as well as sorrow.
And in joy as well as sorrow.
I promise to love you unconditionally.
I promise to love you unconditionally.
To support you in your goals.
To support you in your goals.
To honor and respect you.
To honor and respect you.
To laugh with you and cry with you.
To laugh with you and cry with you.
And to cherish you.
And to cherish you.
For as long as we both shall live.
For as long as we both shall live.
Emily, this is now your chance to say this vow to Tim. Please repeat after me. I, Emily.
I, Emily.
Take you, Tim.
Take you, Tim.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
My constant friend.
My constant friend.
My faithful partner.
My faithful partner.
And my love from this day forward.
And my love from this day forward.
In the presence of God.
In the presence of God.
Our family and friends.
Our family and friends.
I offer you my solemn vow.
I offer you my solemn vow.
To be your faithful partner.
To be your faithful partner.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
In good times and in bad.
In good times and in bad.
And in joy as well as sorrow.
And in joy as well as sorrow.
I promise to love you unconditionally.
I promise to love you unconditionally.
To support you in your goals.
To support you in your goals.
To honor and respect you.
To honor and respect you.
To laugh with you and cry with you.
To laugh with you and cry with you.
And to cherish you.
And to cherish you.
For as long as we both shall live.
For as long as we both shall live.
May I have the rings, please? Tim and Emily have chosen to use rings as the symbol of the vows which we all just heard them say to one another. These rings are made of precious metals with precious jewels. I hope that these precious metals and precious jewels will stand as a symbol to you that the covenant you have made is precious, something to preserve, and something to invest in. They're also circular in nature, to show that there is no beginning and there is no end, to remind you that it is an eternal God, who is love himself, who has granted you the privilege of now being in love with one another. I'm going to give this ring to you. Place this on her ring finger. and say, with this ring, I be wed.
With this ring, I be wed.
And you give that ring, and place that on his ring finger, and say, with this ring, I be wed.
With this ring, I be wed.
Almost there. Tim and Emily have chosen to now light a unity candle as a symbol of their lives being united as one. Tim and Emily were knit together in their mother's womb. Psalm 139 tells us that, but they were fearfully and wonderfully made. Their parents raised them, invested in them, life skills, care, and character, everything they needed to be ready to be bound together today. Each one of them had their own journey, filled with joy, loss, happiness, and sorrow. Their mothers are now going to come and light the individual candles as a representation of their individual journeys. And then in a moment, they will join this flame together. And that will be a symbol of the love that has now been joined together through the marriage covenant. Just as the flame will be joined and cannot be separated, so their lives also have been joined and cannot be separated.
That's a brand new one.
Would you mind?
You
want
to try it?
Yeah.
That's
true.
We're
light and full.
You got it?
Let's go on.
Oh, we have.
Hey, we can use the fireplace.
Here and there's the fireplace, too, honey.
Fireplace inside?
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, guys.
Hey, guys.
There's the fireplace inside, too.
Open up.
Love will come. Love will come. Love always.
a reading from Genesis chapter 2, verses 18 through 24. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh, and shall be called woman, for she was taken out of the man. That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh."
Bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh, joined together as one. Your perseverance, even get the flame together, shows the perseverance that you've had to this moment. And now, from here on, it will take perseverance to preserve the companionship and the romance, but it will be beautiful. It's going to be a wonderful life. I'm so proud of you. You've made it. You're married. And now the moment that Tim's been waiting for, you may kiss your bride. By the state of Colorado and by the Lord Jesus Christ, it is my privilege to pronounce them man and wife, Mr. and Mrs. Tim and Emily Jenkins. Please drop.
Gentlemen, if I can have everyone's attention, we'd like to invite everyone to please find your
your seat. There will be me introducing the members of the wedding party to you shortly. So please find your table. Thank you. Attention to the opening on my right. We're going to be presenting the wedding party to you. First, we have Emily's younger brother and her friend, college teammate of Tim's and the college roommate of Emily's, Jackson and Sarah. A high school friend of Tim's and another of Emily's college roommates, Jordan and Kristen. Emily's high school friend, Doyle and Julie. Tim's high school teammate, Chris, and Emily's cousin, Cassidy. Ryan and Chloe! Tim's college roommate and Emily's childhood friend, Travis and Marissa! Best man and brother, Aaron Heckman, and Emily's maid of honor and sister, Jenna Kemp. And if I could get you to rise and give a big rousing welcome to your new bride and groom, Mr. and Mrs. Tim Jenkin. Seated. And now it's time for a word from our sponsor. We'd like to invite Emily's father, Ben, up for a welcome.
So we also will enjoy a wedding feast, but let's pray and ask Jesus' blessing on this time. Holy Father, we thank you for this very special celebration that we get to enjoy this evening. We thank you for what you have joined together with these two. And Lord, as we celebrate them, their marriage, and their lives, I pray that you will be glorified and honored by the conversations and the fun that we have. Lord, I pray that you will bless this food to our bodies. We love you in your name. Amen. Amen.
Good evening. My name is Ben Kemp, I'm Emily's dad, and I have the great privilege and honor of toasting these two great people here, Emily and Tim. But before I do that, I want to recognize someone special to me. That's my wife, Jan.
Yes, Jan!
This past summer, Jan and I celebrated our 30th wedding anniversary. And I just thank her for all the work, hard work her and Emily did. Between the two of them, they don't miss too much. These guys are incredible. So, I have so many great memories of Emily, and she's such a special daughter to me. And I hope I don't cry here, but I had my cry this morning when she gave me the letter to Mom and I. But I think what really stands out about Emily is her kind heart and just how thoughtful she is. Even when she was really little, I remember this, and we've kind of had this special little thing together about shopping for gifts. Emily is, she's just so thoughtful and remembers everything, and when she was really little, I think in the second grade, her and Jan, I believe they were in a Tuesday morning store, and she had noticed Jan was looking at some ceramic trivets, it wasn't even time for Christmas, but about 4 months went by, and Emily mentioned it to me, and so we went and bought them for Christmas. But that's Emily. She's always been my little elf, little shopping elf. But the best part is the wrapping of the gifts, right? One of the other things that's special about Emily, and I wouldn't do this without mentioning cheerleading, because ever since she was like 9 years old, through college, she was a cheerleader, and just so many special memories about that. And this little girl here is a natural performer. And I can remember when the kids were really little, we did a lot of videoing. Back then, we had the big giant video cameras. I'm sure everybody can remember those days. And watching some of those home videos, I remember Emily. You hear a voice, "Daddy, Daddy, film me, film me." I'd be filming like Kyle or Jenna. And so she never minded the spotlight too much. Maybe the center of attention there and there. But no secret or no surprise that she ended up being a cheerleader. And I just remember all those competitions that we went to when she was young and in high school and in college. And one of the things that I remember is these competitions, if you've ever been, you know what I'm talking about, but they're very long, loud days, a lot of blaring music, lots of cheerleaders, cheering, making a lot of noise, and I would always time my entry to these events around Emily's competition. Her and Jan would go earlier, but I probably made her really nervous. But she'd always make sure I was there and make eye contact with me. So I just enjoyed all those special memories of cheer. And of course, Emily had to be the flyer. And the flyer is the one they put on top of the pyramid. She'd be balancing on one leg, and then they'd flip her down, and they'd throw her about 15 feet in the air. And we all held our breath, but thank God no serious injuries. Maybe a couple of girls down below, some bruises here and there, but those were some special times. But I think really the best part of the cheerleading was the friends that you made. And just the lasting relationships. And I know at Thunder Ridge, these girls were so special that you made friends with, and were friends with their families today. And then at Kansas KU, there you go. You know, just a lot of your teammates supporting you here. So that's really impressive. I think with cheerleading, Emily was just so good with little kids. I mean, she's like a kid magnet. They're just attracted to her. She spent time with them, and I just remember all those years of nannying and babysitting, and she's just really gifted with kids, and I think that's really special. And I'm just so proud that you're a teacher, second grade teacher, and she gets to spend time with kids every day. And I know you're going to be a great mommy. But I love you. You're very special, and you mean so much to me. But you and Tim, you're perfect for each other. And I love you very much. Mr. Tim? Tim is such a joy to be around. Tim is a blessing to our family. And congratulations, Tim. It's been so much fun getting to know Tim and his family. Dale and Don, welcome to the family. You guys are so great. Aaron and Becca as well. We just enjoy getting to know you guys. I don't know if a lot of you know this, but Tim and Emily went to the same high school. They shared a lot of the same memories and experiences, but didn't really date each other. That I know of. Tim probably had his eye on her.
No.
But it wasn't until after college, really, that these two started dating. And it's just been so much fun watching you two grow your relationship, and just so happy you're together. And Tim's got a lot of great qualities. His coaches are over here, and I know that they will attest to this. But Tim is one fierce competitor. And I know that took him really far in sports, the collegiate and pro level and everything like that. But I'm experiencing it now on the recreational level. We love to golf together. We love to have a friendly Monopoly game with the family. Or a trivia game, and we've done some of this past week. But I tell you what, Tim is just... he's so much fun, and he wants to win. And he'll tell you he's winning. But it's all in fun. We love Tim. And on a serious side, Tim is just very passionate, very driven individual. I love that about him. His business, Jenkins Athletics, has just flourished. It's remarkable what he's done with that. And I know you're going to be a great provider, Tim, for your family. So, I appreciate you guys a lot, and I just want to, at this time, just take a glass, if you will, and let's raise a glass to these two beautiful people. May God bless you, Mr. and Mrs. Jenkins.
Our next toaster is the sister of the bride and maid of honor, Jenna Kim.
Hi everyone, pretty sure I know most of you in here, but if you don't know me, I'm Emily's sister, Jenna. First of all, I just want to say a big thank you to Dale and Don Jenkins and my parents, Jan and Ben Kemp, for putting this event on, and merely the reason that we all can be sitting here tonight, and really grateful for them and everything that they've done to make this happen tonight. So. So growing up with Emily was an adventure every single day. I went from being the only child, all the attention on me. Here comes Emily into the world. I'm about 2.5 years old, and I remember I was just so excited to have a little sister. And went from having no one to play with to someone every single day to be by my side. And, you know, at first, you know, I was like, Emily's going to be just like me. You know, I wanted her to do everything I did. You know, my mom dressed us alike. And for a while there, she followed me around, did everything that I did. And then, you know, I don't know, she was probably about four or something, kind of developing her own personality. And she decided, I'm not going to do that anymore. You know, she decided she did not want to be exactly like me. She forged her own path. So, and I remember she was just like the cutest little kid. You know, she had these bright big eyes and wonderful smile, and she was just always, you know, intensely looking at everybody that she talked to, and she was just so cute. And she was also very quirky. She had to have her shoes tied like super tight, and you know, she'd have my dad, any tie on her dress had to be super tight. And, you know, she just was so cute. Any dress she wore, she had to, like, it had to spin. Otherwise, it was not coming out of the closet. It had to do this big spin. And she could not sit still while my mom was doing her hair. And so my mom came up with this scheme, and she decided to get me involved. You know, I was, maybe six or something. And she was like, Jenna, okay, we're going to cut Emily's hair really short, and it's this cute new haircut. You have to help me convince her that it's going to be the coolest haircut. You know, all the kids are doing it. You have to tell her. You know, so I, of course, went along with the plan. Emily, this is going to be the coolest new haircut. And so off went her hair, you know. And Emily, she hated it. But she was still probably even cuter with that haircut. It was just basically like that bowl cut, just one length all the way around. Really easy for my mom because she could just curl it under all the way around and then stick a big bow on the top of her head. So, you know, she was super cute, but she hated it. And from that day on, she would wear this pink towel on her head, and it would like go down her back, and she would just pretend she had this long, beautiful hair. You know, she could not wait to get rid of that hairstyle, but. You know, she was always really cute anyway, but in all seriousness, even though I'm your big sister, there are so many things I look up to you for. Sorry. You know, one of those is your personality. You just put 100% in to everything that you do, you know, like school. You know, your job now, you have all these little second graders, they all look up to you and admire you, and you put 100% into that job, even though you get very little back. And I just really appreciate that. And that's something that you can really admire about somebody. And also, you know, she's so organized. She's got every detail. I mean, look at this wedding tonight. Like, every single detail. Nothing was left untouched. It's beautiful. And, I just really admire that about you. Tim, I remember when I first met you, I thought, oh God, here comes another quarterback. You know, he proved me wrong right away. And he just instantly fit in with our family. And I think the first time I met you, I was not very nice to you, and I'm sorry about that. I was in a really bad mood. I don't remember exactly what happened, but he was like, who is this girl? But anyway, he just knew what he wanted right away with Emily. And, you know, that's why we're here today. He just knew exactly what he wanted. And, that's what makes you guys great together. You're 100% committed to everything you do. You have this like passion for life, and it's just really amazing to watch. And I think that's why you guys are so great together. And Tim is definitely very competitive. One of the first times we hung out, we played this really long game of Monopoly. I think it lasted like 4 or 5 hours, and Tim would not stop until he won. So. But it's that competitive nature that I think a lot of people talked about last night that drives Tim and really makes him, you know, who he is and makes him so successful with his business and everything like that. I mean, to both of you guys, I couldn't be more happy to gain Tim as a brother and to see my sister as happy as she's been over the last couple years. And Emily, it's been so great to see you grow up to be the woman that you are, you know, and the beautiful bride you are today. Loving wife you'll be to Tim and amazing mother that hopefully someday you'll be. So to both of them, let's raise our glass.
And our last toaster is Tim's brother and best man, Aaron Heckerman.
I have a lot to say of toasts. Something new for it, something new might be for it. I look around the room and I say, this must be a fashionable event. It's brought out the finest people. I've always been. But tonight, I hope it's true. I'm Tim's best man, and I'm compelled to say something nice about him. But I'm his older brother, so I'm compelled not to. I hope you find a middle ground. My wife told me, she said, remember the child that you love, and speak of the man before you. I hope to leave you with some truth. From the moment we are born, we are doomed. This man's beauty. His beauty is in his doom. And it forces us to find that what's best in life. It does. I don't regret people that don't search for it. I don't find any pity to give them at all. But I do tell my wife, it's sad that people die. It's the little thing. It's bourbon and cheeses. Dr. Pepper and peanuts. I hear that's big and cheeses. It's a friend, it's a loved one, it's a wife. It's like the water. We come out of nowhere like a wave on the ocean. We peak, and in one moment, we are everything. If we crash on the shore, we're gone. And that's life. But happiness is not a life. Happiness is like a river. We all swim in it. It's what we do every day. We try to stay in the river. We tread water when we have to. But all of us, I know why we do it. We get tired. We feel afraid. We can't keep going. We look back. We wish we were younger. We wish we had things to do again. And we end up on a shore, one or the other. Doesn't matter. And all my life, I've looked back, and I've seen a man in a boat floating right down the middle of the river. It's not hard for him. It's easy. Just floats right along. And it's beautiful because if you've ever been out to sea for any amount of time, it's hard to tread water for a long time. And here comes a man in a boat. And with Tim, we could be anything. It was the young boy who made us believe in impossible dreams would come true. It was the young man who knew that we weren't too old to still have fun and cast off our cynicism. He knew it. And it's tonight that I hope that you are the best of people. Because for the first time in my life, having known Tim on his, I see him going around a bend. He will move to a place in the river that we will not see. He's a man in the boat, and we're on the shore. And I hope that you're the best of people, because it will be up to us to build our own boats, to be like Tim. But for the night, we stand on the shore as Tim and Emily go by in the boat, and we raise our glasses to the good, the bad, for better and for worse, Timothy Emily Jenkin.
Hey, where did we go? And imagine you like all the mothers and sons that are here.
Thank you. stop.